Okay, guys, welcome back. It's Dr. John with another dose of the blues, dose of the rhythm and blues this time. It's the Rolling Stones from 1970, Brown Sugar, one of their most successful songs, big number one on the Billboard charts in 1970. And the album it comes from, Sticky Fingers, was also one of the Stones' most successful. Everybody knows this song, the Walls know it, but in the last 10 years or so, a new narrative has developed about the lyrics being racist. So that's something we can consider while we listen to it. Let's bring it up. Okay.
Thank you.
Well, there it is, Brown Sugar by the Rolling Stones, 1970. It's a great riff. It's an iconic riff. It's a riff that partly defines rock and roll, really. Derived from the blues, from rhythm and blues. Utterly memorable. Mick shows that he'd really learned a lot from Keith's open tunings. Keith told Mick that he'd written songs like Gimme Shelter and Honky Tonk Women using open tunings, Street Fighting Man. And Mick got it very well. And while he was making Ned Kelly in Australia, he came up with this one, the lyrics and the chords, the riff. I'm sure that Keith must have knocked it into shape, into the shape, the final shape. But anyway, we have to credit Mick with the genesis of this song. So, what about the lyrics? Are they racist? Well, I hesitate to call the Stones racist in any way at all. They did so much for black musicians in the States when nobody else from their own country was helping them at all. And they really revered their own blues models. What I would say is that these were guys from Kent in England, and they didn't really fully understand the American social context and the nature of black history in America. So there was probably a certain glib naivety about Mick when he wrote these lyrics, and he said things which would probably have been better left unsaid or said in a different way. Anyway, let's bring up the lyrics and see. They are my first impressions. Let's bring up the lyrics and actually see. So here they are. It starts with a historical reference then to the Gold Coast slave ship bound for cotton fields, sold in the market down in New Orleans. Scarred old slaver knows he's doing all right. Hear him whip the women just around midnight. Well, there's a lot here. There's a historical context, Gold Coast slave ship bound for New Orleans, and the slaves being sold in the market, and a scarred old slaver takes them, and he's a pervert, and he's whipping the women around just around midnight. Certainly unpleasant things being talked about here, especially when we consider the difference in social status between the master and the slaves. Makes it particularly unpleasant. The people from the Gold Coast, they have no choice, and the slave master is just doing whatever he wants. On another level, we could say, well, everybody knows this kind of thing did actually go on. And the guy is a pervert, and probably there were lots of them around at the time. What's more disturbing is the way that Mick kind of continues the narrative from the point of view of the scarred old slaver. So I think all that follows about brown sugar, how come you dance so good, just like a young girl should. All that seems to be from the point of view of the scarred old slaver. So again, that's rather unpleasant. It's Mick identifying himself with the scarred old slaver. Let's bring it up and continue. Yeah, so brown sugar, how come you taste so good? Brown sugar, just like a young girl should. Okay, and then he goes on. Drums beating cold, English blood runs hot. Lady of the house wondering when it's going to stop. Houseboy knows that he's doing all right. You should have heard them just around midnight. Okay, so this very unpleasant narrative continues. So the time frame seems to be before the American Revolution, because there is the reference to English blood runs hot. So yeah, maybe the end of the 17th century, 1680, 1690, beginning of the 18th century, 1720, 30, 40, 50. There are lots of plantation owners who came from England or still identified as being English. So this seems to be the period of time we're talking about. And the scarred old slaver is taking his sexual gratification with the slaves and also beating them, and he's a sadist, basically. And while he's doing this, it looks like his wife is doing the same thing with the houseboy, trying to get back at her husband. So it's mixed mind and a fervor, I think, of things he's read about the slave trade and Black American history. It's not racist perhaps, but it's very unpleasant, and maybe Mick doesn't understand that even the language of English has certain dominant tropes which are embedded in it. So he can't really sing about a scarred old slaver in English and his sexual gratification from his Black slaves without there being an element of racism there. And yeah, unfortunately there probably is, so I don't think it was his intention. Probably the naivety of a Kent boy from England pretending that he knew a lot about Black American history. Okay, let's continue. So same thing continues. Oh, get on, brown sugar, how come you taste so good? I got me craving some brown sugar just like black girl should. How come you dance so good? Ah, and I bet your mama was a tencho queen, and all her boyfriends were sweet 16. I'm no schoolboy, but I know what I like. You should have heard me just around midnight. So, and then we continue with the brown sugar, how come you taste so good? Brown sugar, how come you dance so good? So again, it looks like he's saying the girl's mother was Tencho Queen. I'm not entirely sure what that's a reference to, but it sounds like maybe she could have been a prostitute or something like that. There are definitely elements of racism here, although I'm sure they were not really intended. He just probably wanted to write a kind of interesting amalgam of Black American history, and with the egotism of a young man, he just went ahead and did what he wanted to without thought about the consequences, or if he really knew what he was talking about, which he obviously didn't really. Yes, these things happened, but however, to talk about them and identify with the person who is actually doing these actions, that is racist. That is racist. But I think there Some people would claim there is a counter narrative there as well to offset what I was just talking about, the fact that the scarred old slaver thinks that he is superior, but is the fact that he is himself a slave to the black women shows that really there is no superiority. He is just a slave to them, in fact. So there is a counter narrative there which is talking about basic equality of everybody. You might pretend that you're better than someone, but when it comes down to basics, everyone is the same. Having said that, it doesn't justify what went before. For me, the most disturbing thing about this is that Mick actually identifies with the scarred old slaver. So the scarred old slaver thinks he's doing all right, and he's whipping the women just around midnight. And then in spite of that, Mick continues to talk about brown sugar from the point of view of this scarred old slaver, which is disturbing, really, and should never have been done. So I think that if now he is older and wiser, I hope that he would accept that that was a mistake, and he would have written the words in a somewhat different way. However, so, having said all that, it's still a great song and one of the best riffs in rock and roll. So, hope you enjoyed my reaction and the song. If you did, subscribe to the channel and hit the like button. Thanks a lot. Thanks.